had this great video ready to be taped here. I said, wow, this is going to be fabulous. So I go outside and I'm getting set up and I see this cat is fixated on something. And I say, huh, let me check what it is. I don't see what it is. Oh, my gosh. So I'll start the video out in this way, and it's not the way I wanted to start it, but it's better than expected. It's the grace of God. A tiny little infant bird, a cat had got this tiny little infant bird and was just watching it, and it was struggling. It was terrible. You know, just hatched out of the egg, so to speak, yeah. And the poor little, I don't want to give a description, but I said, what do I do? What do I do? This is terrible. This is terrible. Oh, my gosh. And I said, well, you know what? I don't want that cat toying with this bird. I'm not going to just let this bird sit there to die and have this cat, you know, gloat and toy over it. It says, no way. What do I do? Well, we have this sago palm, I guess you might call it, or a type of, is that what it's called? But real thick, and the spines are very sticky, and it's up. And I picked up the bird, and I put it underneath this palm tree that was protected. The cat can't get to it. The cat tries to get to it, the cat will get all stuck with all these spines and stuff, and it can't get to it. So I let the bird relax at peace there. The bird is suffering, of course, but it's protected. It's protected from the cat now. And so this is a metaphor. Guy was giving me a metaphor here of what's to come, because I've been contemplating dropping meditation, actually. This whole world is just a meditation, and the bodies are meditation that we're doing. The natural state is free of all meditation, all concentration. It takes great effort to deceive ourselves into not seeing intrinsic spaciousness. So we're actually meditating on bodies, meditating on this world, meditating on this form and this appearance as if it were form. Everyone's in a trance state here. This is actually, so it's just actually dropping the trance state, dropping the meditation, that we just awaken to natural being. This is a fact. So last couple of days I've been working on flipping the script, and I'm really making great headway on that. I've taped a lot of audio tape, but I don't want to inundate you with too many videos. I realize this is it may be too much for most. So I just try to condense it all here. So what's important is that we don't get caught up in the drama of what's to come. July 24th, drama should start off at that point. Very bad. And we don't want to get caught up in the drama, which is why I'm saying boycott it. I'm using very skillful means. I was blessed with precognition. I'm aware of what's to come. So what I do is I know what's coming. I diffuse it in my mind before it arrives, so that the drama, I just go, blah, you know. It's no big deal. Been there, done that already. You see, and so you don't get attached to the drama. You don't get pulled down by it. So I'm aware of what's coming. The Holy Spirit has given me a heads up on this. It's been, you know, very, very, very great heads up on this. July 24th, 2016. We want to be situated in such a place, a situation, by the end of May, I believe, so we can get used to, accustomed to it. Somehow, we want to be in a place where we're protected from the drama, and we're not going to get pulled into the drama. We're just going to ride it out and not paying attention to it. Because the drama is staged, it's intentionally staged for us, for the purpose of deepening our meditation. Now, we're used to saying in meditation that we need to meditate. No, really, we need to drop all meditation. The identification with the body is a meditation, actually. It's a profound trance state meditation. Self-hypnosis, you might even call it. This is our problem. Reality isn't meditating. in order to not see intrinsic spaciousness, the one intrinsic spaciousness, that we can never leave it, and not see that, we have to go work on these trance states. So there's all this drama is designed to deepen our trance states, deepen our coma, you might call it. So the highest teaching, which I've been fortunate enough to be involved with, is dropping all meditation, dropping all contemplation. This is the actual truth, which is why I really never meditated. I said, no, that's you don't want to do that. Now, because we're so addicted to that, some do is they use that meditation ability to free themselves from meditation, okay? But you don't have to do it that way. You don't have to do that. There's many, many ways to come out of this trance state. And what's important is all falsity, all not seeing of intrinsic spaciousness is simply just not seeing of intrinsic spaciousness. There's nothing to, no distinctions to draw whatsoever. No distinctions to draw whatsoever. So it's not so much that we're born in this world, it's that we decide to fixate, meditate on a body. So what we're doing is we're really meditating on a body. The body is just this meditation device. You like in meditation here, they might take a flower or a rock or something and concentrate on it. Well, the body is just like that flower or rock. We're concentrating our meditation on this body and the senses and what it's seeing. We're focused. That's actually trance state, meditational state. Actually, that's what's going on. So we need just to relax from all our meditation efforts, actually. That's the truth. It's that simple. It's so easy. It's what's difficult is not seeing intrinsic spaciousness or denying it. That's what's excruciatingly difficult, because we're all always just an easy shift away from seeing it, no matter what we do. It's like the shadow that's dogging us no matter where we go. So we might as well just let God, you know, surrender, let God catch us, you know, really let vision catch us, because it's going to catch us anyway. We can run, but we can never hide from it. It's always with us, and it takes massive trance state fixation and effort to imagine that we're not seeing it. And so we might as well just give up. And just, you know, this is called surrender, submission on the spiritual path, is submitting to the inevitable. You might as well just submit to the inevitable that we're going to wake up from this meditation of separateness, of distinctions, you know, falsity, of arrogance, of trying to be better than God is what it is. Might as well just let's say, okay, I give up. I'm caught. No more running. So this is the practice, full stop in the wild. We're just not running anymore. No running. Not remembering running, not planning to run, not scheming to run, not thinking about running, not deciding to run, not taking the action of running. So we don't decide, we don't think about it, we don't plan, we don't organize, we don't decide, we don't run. We don't wander around saying, well, I'm not running, because that's getting into the action of running, right? Well, it's running, but claiming we're not going in a direct line, so it's not running. No, as we aimlessly wander around, that's running too. Running it, absolutely. So we just full stop in the wow. Very skillful means. It's a terrible cat. It brings lizards in constantly and catches birds. It's just a terrible. So God's saying, look, you can be protected from this cat, this mentality. It's a very paranoid cat, too. Extremely paranoid. It's not my cat. Believe me. Extremely paranoid cat. It's mirroring the consciousness, you know. A paranoid cat pulling in the reptilians, pulling in lizards, and attacking birds. Birds symbolize freedom. I love birds. The ability to instantly fly is symbolic of instantly going into spaciousness, right? Shifting into spaciousness. Birds can instantly shift into spaciousness. Now, this isn't intrinsic spaciousness they're shifting into. It's space spaciousness, which is also abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness. But it's a metaphor. It's a symbol, isn't it? So this cat, paranoid cat, is trying to kill this young bird, you see. And I said, wow, it's still alive. let's put it in a sheltered place. Let's put it in a sheltered place. It's struggling. It's like, ah, oh, I can't, I don't know if I can, I'll be able to fly. Well, let's put it in a sheltered space. I know Ram Maharshi, what did he, some little bird fell in the nest and he picked it up and breathed on it. And for many days, and I think, I don't know, was it a bird or it was some little animal? I think it might have been. And ultimately, it recovered. It was astonishing to everybody what happened. So we give all prayers and blessings to that little bird. We understand this is something that it's a grace of God that is showing us what we need to do. Shelter, some sort of refuge, really. Do not want to fixate on these dramas. So what I've been doing is one of the biggest dramas is staging the fake return of Jesus. Jesus is already back in the world, but he is not here to be idolized, to be this rock star, and to be fixated upon, okay? Not at all. These teachers don't really want you fixating on their bodies. The darshan viewing is more of the feeling of no fixation on the body. The great guru is not fixated on their body at all. Ananda Maima was basically not even aware of her body. She never identified or fixated on her body at all. And she didn't know how to eat, didn't know the difference between pain, you know, danger and non-danger in terms of like, you know, pain and pleasure, no fixation on the body at all. So that's the darshan that's really taking place, no fixation on the body. So there is this intent in the mind to stage a fake return of Jesus as a spiritual rock star. Okay, the real Jesus is already back. I've already met with him, and in that meeting, he prostrated on the ground to speak with me, and so I prostrated myself on the ground too. He wanted to point out, I'm not here to be elevated as some spiritual rock star at all. He said, I'm here just to relate with all you as a friend. So he lowered himself down like that, as low as it, so we would not. Couldn't fixate. He was literally lying prostrate on the ground. And then I did too. Face to face, we were talking that way. But you couldn't really fixate on his body at all, right? So he's not here for us to develop a body fixation upon him at all. Not at all. The other times I've been with Jesus, he'll just like just sit quietly, just very tranquil and quiet, peacefully, just sitting there. And he'll talk, but it's very calm. Very calm, relaxed, peaceful speech. It's not Jesus, the spiritual rock star. Okay, that's a fake return played by an actor. But this is an intention to cause this massive drama in the world. The other dramas are coming also, and there also, like I said, there could be multiple Jesuses, multiple Messiahs showing up to create this massive drama, body fixation. Various traditions have different expectations for a Messiah, and they may be staged, a fake Messiah will be staged for them. And they may have some cities, some concentrated meditative miracle capacities. That's not a big deal at all. It's really the non-attachment that Jesus has, these great teachers have. Total non-attachment. They realize there's just intrinsic spaciousness, that's it. They're not fixated on any form or definition whatsoever, including their body. So, seeing that this is coming, and this is one of the big ones. This is the time of the great deception that are coming up this summer, this spring and summer. July 24th is also right in between the two political conventions. The first Republican, about the 18th through the 21st, I think, and then the Democrat is the, what, the 27th through the 29th, something like that. So it's like smack dab in the middle of the two conventions. And, you know, there may be riots breaking out after the Republican convention. That's very possible. And super drama shaping up, super drama politically. But you say, well, that's just the United States. But the United States being the superpower of the world, this is a drama that affects everyone, really. So, you know, everyone in the world is going to be talking about it and focusing on it in some way, really. And people getting sucked into this drama, I say, boycott politics. The Holy Spirit told me, you got to boycott it. If it says that, there's a reason. It's not just saying, well, you know, just because it make you a good person or something. No, no. It's a very important spiritual reason. Same thing with sports. I'm boycotting sports. I'm not following the dramas of stuff. It's very sneaky. You start following storylines, and then gradually it pulls you into it. It's very, actually, last night I did take a peek at something I shouldn't have, but I just realized, okay, you can't get into storylines. As soon as you start getting into storylines, then you'll find another storyline. Then you say, well, I want to follow the storyline. So it happens just like with one person, like one single figure, and then ultimately you get pulled into the entire drama of sports. So I'm like looking up Tim Lincecum. I want to see what he's doing. And then I see some other stories there, and you look up with him, and then, you know, sidebar headlines and stuff. Oh, what's happening with the Jared Parker or something? Oh, let me look at him. Oh, and then you see Colin Kaepernick. And then you see, oh, what's happening with Colin Kaepernick? And before you know it, you start to become pulled into all the drama, soap opera drama of all the stuff. So it starts out by just following one drama like that, and you get pulled into all of it. It's very, very deceptive and sneaky. It's a slippery slope. And you hear people talking in stores about the Warriors and they're running records and all this stuff, and you think, oh, maybe I should check. I say, no, it's a slippery slope. Very much so. So, again, for the highest recommendation is boycott politics, boycott sports, boycott these world dramas, detach from them right now. And you could do it for three months. What's the big deal? If we can't have discipline for 3 months, then how can we wake up from our trance state of not seeing intrinsic spaciousness? How can we? If we can't even have discipline for 3 months at the most crucial time in history, it's amazing. I try to get through to people and it doesn't get through to them. They say, well, yeah, I can have a discipline. But if not now, when? This is the crucial time to have it. This is what the Holy Spirit has told me. If you can't do it now, you know, then you get pulled down into continual trance states and greater efforts to maintain the trance states. Terrible efforts. Super control. Terrible techno-fascistic control systems that try to keep us maintaining our trance state, which is just a meditation on bodies and things, really, is all that it is. So we don't see the intrinsic spaciousness, that nothing is moving in the slightest regard, in relation to pure spacious, intrinsic spacious. Nothing is happening, nothing is moving. This is Ram Maharshi's vision of the stillness. So these things are just daily disciplines, you know, like get up, I stretched today, I worked on a launch monitor yesterday, golf launch monitor, I'm sore, my neck hurts, it was amazing. And again, I'm just interspersing, you can feel the intensity of this video, what I'm saying. I've already said some very startling things, okay, so we can take a little, you know, pause in this, I work on a launch monitor. It's a golf, it's a laser, some sort of laser beam for golf that you hit off a tee and the ball goes past, breaks the laser beam and it catches the spin and angle and speed of the ball and is able to, and then it shows on the screen, like as if it shows the ball sailing out there and it curves according, you know, to the spin and it goes according to the speed, how far, and it shows you what your shot actually would really be on a golf course. It's quite amazing. it catches your swing speed somehow. So I was actually working on this. It's only the second time I've done it, but this time I was like, I said, you know what? This is your one opportunity. Seize the moment and get it right. Because I was doing lousy, really terrible, and I was shocked. I said, wow, I've been working out every day in my swing, and it's horrible. And I told myself, look, you have to, this is a great opportunity here. It may not come again. I may be too busy for this. I just happened to have the opportunity. Seize the opportunity. So I kept working at it, and I kept working. It was just awful. I said, and then a little better, then bad again. And swing speed was down. Everything was lousy. I said, holy cow. But I'm not going to give up. I said, now is the time. I have to dial it in somehow. So I just kept working at it. I don't know how many balls I hit. It must have been 150. I don't know. Just a lot. And finally, I started dialing it in. And by the time, finally, the last ball I hit was like just right down the middle, 265, I think. 265 right down the middle. I'd been hitting it, you know, 260, 270 something, you know, just like right down the middle. I said, I just stopped that. I said, okay, I understand. I've got it dialed in. I understand what I'm doing. But it took a lot of doing, you know, trying so many different things. And finally, I was just able to realize, you know, that just the right ball position and the right grip and the right focus, my head turned in the right direction, everything aligned in the right way, then I started getting consistent results and really, you know, really good consistent results. Whereas before, you know, terrible stuff. It was just all over the place. It's just awful. Left and right and short and just, it was no consistency, no good results. And then suddenly just the right alignment. Everything was aligned properly. I said, okay, this is my swing. This is the swing that really works for me. I was using a Titleist 915D4, I think it was. Titleists are very good clubs. It just, they're supposedly hard to hit. But if you hit them right, you know, it's really good. The other clubs I use weren't as good. I use like three different drivers, I think. I was demoing them. So I was smacking this Titleist, you know, 260. And if I was stronger, I hadn't been doing all these jump ropes and wasn't tired on Friday. If I was, yeah, my swing speed was only 90, but I should be able to do like 95 at least. Yeah, if I feel real strong, maybe 100, the ball's going to go even further. It'll go 280 probably. So it's there, but I had the feedback that helped me dial it in. And so we can look at our spiritual practice as, we know we can do it. We just have to dial it in. You just have to work at it. And then you'll get it. You'll say, oh, okay. Now I've got it. I have a way to get free of the trance states, you know? Yeah. But you cannot be caught up in the drama. You know, there's all this other stuff going on around me. I just didn't pay any attention to it. No attention. I'm just working on this. I don't care what else was happening anywhere in the world at that point, really. All thoughts of the world actually vanished. When you're working on a launch monitor and you're struggling and you feel like you have to get it, I can't think of any other thoughts I was having, really, except pick up the ball, put on the tee, and do better this time. Yeah, the world ceased to exist, actually, in terms of my thinking about it or being attached to it. It's quite amazing. So, the fake return of Jesus, what I'm doing is playing the rock star in advance. I say, okay, well, I'll be a rock star. Let me be the rock star. Let me be a rock star here, and get used to it. And they just say, ah, okay, well, yeah, so what? There's a rock star, or, you know, somewhere in Santa Monica. Okay, it's fine. I've been a rock star too, and I'm not attached to that anymore as much. You break the, you take the edge of the drama and interest and intrigue off of it. You take the edge off of it. So I show up, dress up like a rock star, so to speak, like a spiritual rock star. Just subtly, you know, but just, it's just there. Because it has this fire breaking, I call it fire breaking, which is, I've said this before many times, is if there's a huge forest, for instance, that's dry, and you realize at some point, this, we're going to have a terrible wildfire here. You know, it's guaranteed, isn't it? It's not maybe. It's when. So there's areas of the Pacific Northwest right now that are just all dead trees. There is just, and we've had, of course, last summer we had the fires up there. I didn't follow that drama at all, but someone just mentioned it to me. I've been checking out of world dramas for a long time now. I don't follow the news. And but when you have a massive forest of all these trees and that are all dead, okay, lightning is going to strike at some point, right? It's not 99% sure, it's 100% sure that you're going to have a terrible wildfire. Now, let's say you had a little community in this forest. What would you do? What do you do? Well, what you do is you get... You clear an area around the community, a certain area. Clear some. It's a lot of work, I understand. So, and then you backburn part of the forest. But you first you make a fire break so that the fire won't jump the fire break into the rest of the forest and start the huge wildfire. And then you got to make sure the conditions are calm. Then you start a fire and you burn this area around the community. You burn it down. So then there's a big area that's already burned. Okay. Then when the wildfire happens, it's coming toward the community, runs out of fuel. There's no fuel there. So the community is spared. It's called backburning. You do a fire break and then you backburn. This is part of what firefighters do, actually. You see them on freeways doing controlled burns, back burning, so, you know, to prevent, you know, a terrible wildfire. So, the conditions in this world are such that there's going to be a terrible wildfire. There's no doubt about it. It's like a dead forest. You know there is going to be. So you have to backburn the situation. So this is what I do. I backburn. I've used precognition. I know it's coming. I backburn. So when the terrible situation comes, there's no fuel. I don't have any fuel. I've already burned the fuel. So going around like a rock star, in spiritual rock star, it's backburning. I get used to it. I get used to people's, you know. So I say, hey, I'm out there. I sort of pre-enact the situation. I pre-enact it. So when the New World Order drama, when they push it, there's no more fuel, very little fuel with me. I'm just like, been there, done that. This really doesn't have the hook, you know. It doesn't hook me. I might still feel some, but the barb is off the hook. It slips out of my mouth. It doesn't really hook me. This is very skillful means, using precognition and backburning, which is really what I've done. Like Ananda Mayama helped me with that, like this playing the goddess role in some certain ways. And I'm already now just, blah. You know, Ananda Mayama, okay, doesn't hook me. This means that, you know, I won't be hooked by the goddess deception, which is coming too. It's not just Jesus. It's also, they'll enact like Virgin Mary coming into the world, or a goddess or something like that. And that'll hook a lot of people too. There's no greater goddess than Ananda Mayama. She's a queen of all Dakinis, you know. That's the role that one of the roles she helped us with, playing that. And for me, it's already It's been how many years? Almost 19 years. It's just like, ah, blah, there's no hook. There's no hook anymore. There's no hook. It's all burned out. All that's already burned out. So I'm not likely to get caught up in that. It's just, you know, there might be some initial buzz or something, but the enthusiasm just isn't there in me anymore. It's just not there. It's gone. So you don't get hooked into a deepened trance state of fixation on bodies, which pulls you into another, not only another life, another meditation on bodies, but it may be a whole cycle of meditation upon bodies, you see. Frees you from all, you call it birth and death, but it's just all meditative fixations upon form. Instead of seeing it as just mere appearancing, spaciousness ornamenting itself, it's ornamenting its own intrinsic spaciousness. As Longchenpa puts it, beautiful. Longchenpa is a fabulous teacher of all this, who points it out, fabulous capacity to point this out to us. But also he was in a tradition of fabulous pointing out this. So this backburning, so I just really pre-enacting some of the things that this fake return to Jesus is likely to do, then I say, well, yeah, I've already done that. The buzz is off of that for me. So I don't really need to participate in that. Otherwise, you know, the drama is, people get sucked into the drama. It's just, right, the adrenaline, the rush, you forget your worldly troubles. It's such a enthusiastic drama of what's going on. Very heady stuff, very intoxicating stuff. People get profoundly intoxicated by it. Absolutely. There'll be dancing and singing and just the whole thing. I mean, it'll just be very intoxicating. Seem like some massive spiritual revival, but they're really just going into deeper trance states. The goddess, the yoga girls will help with that, help fixate on their bodies. They'll use themselves as fixation tools. First they get all the enthusiasm going, and then the fixation comes. Yeah, there's a whole way that it happens. So we're headed towards massive drama that you want to sidestep. Sidestep the drama. Backburn it ahead of time. And those with precognition, such as myself, are very helpful. But most people don't quite understand the advice. And to me, it's very crystal clear. If you know what's coming ahead of time and it's designed to pull you into deeper deception, then burn off all the interest in it ahead of time. So when it arrives, you just, not that interested. But, you know, there's plenty of drama for everybody coming up. So you really have to be able to detach from all of it. It's like the rock stars, you know. I've been there, done that. You know, backburn it all. It's like now some rock star comes on the scene. I just go, you know, so what? No interest, really. Maybe just passing, you know, like some Edward Van Halen bursts on the scene right now. Some new style or something. It's like, yeah, okay. That's kind of cool, but I can't keep the interest going. I just like that. Take the headphones off. So that's enough. Let's get back to work here on awakening from our meditation fixation on bodies. So the overall scene, you know, rock scene can't pull me in. Really, it just doesn't have the juice anymore. The world just doesn't have the juice to pull me in because I've backburned it all. But you know, like firefighters who do backburning, it's a very serious discipline. You have to know what you're doing. This is so what we're doing here is very serious, and you know they're very cautious. They have to be, right? They have to have the water there. If it gets too starts getting too much, they tame it down. They got to make sure the wind is not blowing. So full stop in the wild. It's like no wind, no, you know, keep the fire contained. It's a contained fire is what we're doing, making sure the fire is contained, so we don't get take action from a wow, the enthusiasm we feel. Ah, what is this? 1 minute, please. All right, well, that's good. I guess I could have some work today, which will help out. I'm really having trouble with the finances and work and everything. It's just crazy. It's terrible. But still have to keep this back burning going here. Do not want to get caught up in the drama that's to come. And so precognition alerts us. Now, there's one thing that when you alert, when we become aware of the intention of something like this, a contrived drama that's coming up, a fake stage like Return of Jesus, you know, it's possible that if we become aware of that, oh, this is aware of it, okay, then they won't do it. You know, because they say, oh, it's not going to work so well because people already have lost interest in it. They've already worked it through, not really interested in it. So becoming aware of things before they happen, oftentimes we decide not to do it. Our intentions change. The mind's intentions change. This is why prophets, some people say, oh, you prophesied this was going to happen and it didn't happen. You're a false prophet. That is not necessarily true at all. Look at Jonah prophesizing to Nineveh, saying, you know, wrath is going to come upon you if you don't repent. And they repented and it didn't happen, you see. So the idea of a prophet is saying, this is going to happen unless you repent. So I'm saying this false staging of Jesus is very likely, false return, staging of Jesus' return, false return is likely to happen unless we repent. Now, if we repent and are no longer interested in it, well, you know, those who are want to do this for the purpose of deepening our fixation so they can control us better out of their paranoia, trying to calm their paranoia down, they'll say, oh, that's not going to work. So let's do something else. They've got to plan something else. So that doesn't make someone a false prophet at all. So our awareness is very powerful. And when our interest is not there, then that changes what the staging changes it. You know, what if they had a war and nobody was interested? You know, the war would probably stop. Because this is just a distraction to fixate. It's fixation. Yeah, we don't have to have war. And if nobody's interested at all in the drama of war, mentally we wouldn't be able to do it. To a large extent, really. Our desire for fixation is like the dead trees. So the more we desire to fixate on bodies and things and avoid seeing intrinsic spaciousness, the more dead trees we have. And right now in this world, the whole world is like is one big forest of dead trees. So all there has to happen is a spark, you know, lightning to strike, and the whole world is going to be burning with this intense drama. We're told the world's going to be destroyed by fire. But what does that mean? Is that a spiritual metaphor for this intense, frenzied enthusiasm of drama? Like a fire? You know, when you're really fired up by drama, it's like a burning fire in you. It's terrible. It seems fun for a while, but then it's just too much, and then you just stop, and it won't stop. That's when the fun turns into agony. Crazy. I was looking at some of the rock acts in the 70s and 80s and 90s. Their purpose is to drive the crowd into a frenzy. Go berserk. They're just up there going berserk. I want to go berserk. Whereas it's like to contrast like a classical concert, but even like country music, classic country music is, you know, just singing these sort of gentle, soft ballads and mournful ballads and getting helping you realize, wow. Somebody else is suffering pain also, and you know, it puts you in sort of a calm, relaxed, let's not fixate on the world so much mood. It's totally different. Or, you know, not all this rowdy clapping and people jumping but screaming. It's amazing that the music that we've gone through over the last 50 years or so, super rowdy, super berserk music. I was helped to get out of that by going to classic country music, George Jones. And I said, wow, this is so much better. The mood, it puts you in so much better. Calms you down. Really smooths out and calms down. Classical music is actually pretty rowdy on its own if you listen to it. All this, just all this woodwind, it's all this, you know, humming interest, so to speak. And then opera, of course, is super dramatic. But classic country said, man, I woke up this morning, I walked outside, and there's a dead bird, you know, cat had just killed a bird, and that's like, and the rain clouds are gathering, and I don't have much work, and I'm running out of money. And it's just a song about like, yeah, you know, fixation sucks, you know, basically, to put it bluntly. this fixation on bodies is just terrible. And don't bother to try to cheer me up because I don't feel like it right now. That's like, you know, I just don't give a damn by George Judge. Hey, right now I just don't care. You know, I don't care about us. about trying to make, you know, help, you know, special relationships help one another fixate on bodies and personalities and things, is that I just don't care anymore. I just don't feel like it anymore. I'm just not into it anymore. Classic country lottery. I'm just not into the world anymore, actually. And I don't know how it's going to work out for me, but that's just the way it is right now. So don't bother trying to pique my interest right now. They call it drinking music or something, but I don't get that out of it. But a lot of people do this. I just feel like drinking and just, you know, not rowdy drinking, but just drinking and just saying, wow, I'm not interested in the world anymore. So we gotta be very careful about not going into rowdy music. Now, folk music is activism, actually. So you have to be careful about activism. Whereas classic country is, I woke up this morning and aching with pain. Don't think I can work, but I'll try. Yeah, so what do? I woke up this morning, I'm aching in pain. Woke up this morning, aching in pain. Don't think I can work. Yeah, that's exactly. Dead bird, woke up this morning aching with pain. I feel so tired, I don't know if I can work. That's it. My wife left and didn't say why. She left all the bills on the desk in the hall. These days I barely get by. Right? Yeah. It's like, I just, you know, I want someone who can pay my bills. And you know, you just don't have enough work to pay my bills. Exactly. Exactly what's going on, right? Yeah. This is like, but it's put this to music, and so it says, hey, wait a minute, this is what's going on, wow. I walked home from work and it rained all the way. Yeah, my wife left and didn't say why. She put all her bills on the desk in the hall. These days I barely get by. Yeah, my car broke down. I had to walk home from work. Got home, there's a little baby bird is dying. I'm hungry, don't have money, I'm aching, I'm tired. Yeah, it's like, oh, thank you for connecting me with what's really going on, what the price I'm paying for this fixation. Thank you for reminding me of this. So I love classic country, and it's slow. There's that soft slipkey piano, there's violins, there's pedal steel, mournful pedal steel, and it's spacious, very spacious. It's like giving you an opportunity to connect with intrinsic spaciousness. You can understand the words. It's not frantic, it's the opposite of frantic. It's like, let's just sit down for a minute here. Previous fixations are haunting me. I know I can't go back to them. I've already tried to drink them away. It doesn't work. I'm out of work. Can't pay the rent. I say, wait a minute, what is this? What is the price I'm paying for these fixations? So it doesn't try to like get rid of it through frantic, go berserk. No, it just says, let's just take a minute here and recognize, wow, I feel terrible. Basically, the classic country, a lot of it is to say, just, you know what? Well, Jones and stuff, I feel terrible. How do you feel? Probably pretty terrible too, right? So let's just say, just wait a minute here. Let's calm down. let's take that as a first step. You know, it's like, let's repent. It's very repentant-oriented music. It came from Southern gospel music, came from sort of a Puritan Christianity, Protestantism, in its more pure style, of like, hey, we need to repent here. Let's slow down and repent. Often, sometimes there's songs about, you know, graveyard, taking flowers to my mom in the graveyard. It makes you stop and say, whoa. Yeah. This is what happens here, isn't it? So it's very spiritual, actually. It connects us with the hideousness of this fixation, which is our arrogance, trying to be greater than God, trying to define reality. Trying to define freedom. We're practicing by fixating on bodies. Imagining, projecting these appearances and fixating upon them. Classic country. Yeah, when I met you, it was like unbelievably great, but now all you do is yell at me. I've tried everything I could possibly try. Nothing works. I can't change you. You can't change me. This isn't working. This is terrible. It talks a lot about the troubles of the special relationship. But nowadays, the country music is very, very, very different. It's terrible. It's all enthusiasm for the special relationship. Wow, she walked in with blue jeans, and there's all these tattered holes in her blue jeans. As at the golf store, there's this. You know, it's not really a yoga girl, but yeah, you know, in a different guise. There's a couple walked in, and this girl's in this blue jeans, but they're just like all these tattered holes and rips everywhere. You know, completely staged that way. Intentionally, of course, super distressed, just like, wow, I mean, just, you know, look in tatters here, it's just so chic and cool. That's like the anti-yoga girl chic, which is still yoga girl chic all the way, because she was so chic in her, you know, overall, just like, I'm totally chic. I'm country chic. So it's all about this enthusiasm for the special relationship now, country music. Whereas the old classic country is saying, wow, my enthusiasm for the special relationship was this incredibly stupid thing. It's the stupidest thing I've ever done. Hello. You know, I need to go back to church. I'm in a bar room trying to forget about how stupid I was. But what I really need to do is I need to get back to church. So now I'm sitting here in church saying, God help me, because I was really a fool. I'm really a stupid fool here. This is real country music. This is classic country music. It's spiritual. Very much so. It's actually a type of spiritual practice, which I did for many years. Don't get carried away by the enthusiasm of materialism. You might say, you know, today I bought a cheap pair of shoes that looked great on the shelf, made in China, but 2 weeks later all the glue came undone and the soles fell off. And I don't have any money to buy another pair. What an idiot I am. What kind of stupid world is this? So, if you like play the role of rock star Jesus, when the fake comes, the fake actor, and the whole big drama comes, you can say, "Ah, I've already been rock star Jesus. You know what? Didn't really do anything for me. It's no big deal. It was really blah. You know, it didn't, you know, maybe give you a little kick for a little while, but other than the kick's gone, it's just, everything's still terrible, right? So it's nothing. Forget it. That's backburn the whole situation out. Now, the whole goddess thing is very tough to backburn. It's taken me almost 19 years of working on that. That's an even deeper, tougher one, because it taps into to our fundamental fixation with the mother, right? Absolutely. That's our primary fixation. That's like the root of fixation is the mother. And we start fixating. The mother teaches us how to fixate. Helps us fixate. Now, and on to my mom, when she was born, she didn't fixate. People thought there was, that she had suffered brain damage during birth. She didn't have this mother-child fixation. She just sat there silently. No crying, nothing, just sitting there silently, quietly. So people said, oh my gosh, the poor like a little bird, right? Oh, poor little bird. This has been horribly damaged. This is awful. They felt so sorry for the mother that they had a child like that that had suffered severe brain damage during birth. This is what they thought. She was completely dutiful, did everything they said, but as far as this intense bond of fixation, learning how to fixate, nothing. They said, sit here and be quiet. We're going to market. Can you just sit here and be quiet? Don't move. Don't go anywhere. She said, of course. And then people go by and say, what's that? It's just like a statue. And if they didn't tell her not to do that, she'd stay as still as a statue, like carved in stone. No fixation upon action here, anything. Not pulled into any of that drama at all. So the other kids be running around playing, doing all this stuff, and she'd just be still as a stone. The body would be, right? What did not work on fixation at all? Except in the Leela of Sadhana and Bhajatpur, where they had the Kaol or the spiritual grace to say, how would it be the Holy Spirit, Sambhogakaya, Holy Spirit, she called the Kaol, said, how would it be to play the role of a sadhika or a spiritual aspirant? So she played the role of the spiritual aspirant and the guru simultaneously. And the method, everything did all of that simultaneously herself. And so what she did was, she played all the, put herself into all these fixations, and then the spiritual path of undoing that fixation, and went through thousands a day, you know, literally, because there's really infinite combinations, really, there's so many, and she just would go through all these paths, like really fast, and just take them all the way to no fixation. To intrinsic spaciousness again. And went through all the different mudras and mantras of various, you know, paths, some of the Mahamudra paths and the various Buddhist paths and Hindu paths that they use. You know, the Kriya Yoga, the Upa Yoga and the Acharya Yoga and the Kriya Tantras. Charya Upa Tantras, and then the Yoga Tantras, and then the Anuttara Yoga Tantras, which is the subtle winds and energies in the body. That's like a fourfold division that's often used in esoteric practice. The Kriya Tantra is more exoteric, of cleanliness, all these rituals of cleanliness, they do that and stuff. And the deity, you know, deity worship comes later, the generation stage, and then the completion stage of visualizations, all these, and then mantras, various symbols, body, speech, and mind, trying to purify it all. So she put herself through this practice of a sadhu, or once on doing these practices, sadhana is doing these skillful means of freeing from fixation. She put herself through all of that, played the role of thousands and thousands, maybe hundreds and hundreds of thousands of different sadhus on different spiritual paths, taking all of them to vision again of intrinsic spaciousness. It's called the Leela of Sadhana at Bajetpur. She was living in Bajetpur, which is in Bangladesh, on a river, in a little hut, little corrugated tin shack there, really. Not fancy homes, no. This is possible to do. And she did all of that. So just dissolving all these fixations. The spiritual paths themselves are fixations, which is what Ati Yoga says in Nyingma Dzogchen Vajrayana Buddhism. There's like 9 divisions or yanas, vehicles, divided into 9. Different stages. They start out with the exoteric practices, and then the 3 divisions of that. Then they go into the 3 divisions of esoteric practices, which are, and then the 4th stage, which in the Sarma traditions, which are the newer translations of Tibetan Buddhism. Which the Sakya, Kagyu, and Gelugpa traditions, those 3, they just have 4 stages on the path, and the 4 stages on Anuttara Yoga, which is this inner, they call it winds and energies and nerve channels and all this stuff, they work with that. That in Dzogchen teaching is divided into 3 stages. So esoteric practices, they actually, Nyingma has like 6 stages of that. Takes the 4th stage of Sarma teachings and divides it into 3 different stages. And it's like Maha, Anu, and Ati Yoga. Maha Yoga, something like that. Anu Yoga and Ati Yoga. The highest is the Ati Yoga. But from the peak, it's recognized that all of this was just fixation. Okay. This is what Longchenpa is pointing out to us. He says, go directly to the top. Take the top. Take authenticity as the path. This is this practice of, I'm already there. Yet I can, I will, I'm already there, which corresponds to the exoteric practices of good conduct, purifying all your conduct and discipline, all these things. I can do it, then I will do it is more the esoteric practices. And then saying, I've already done it, is the Ati Yoga, or the highest practice, which takes it as it's already here. It's already perfect. There's nothing I need to do. I just need to drop all attempts to do anything, actually. That's the real teaching. It's all my attempts to reach realization that itself is the fixation. So Ananda Mahima knew how to dissolve all the different past fixations. So whenever someone came to her, she'd say, okay, what's your path? I see your path perfectly. I've already done it. And I've already taken all the way through. So I know exactly what to tell you, how to advise you. That's true. Everyone said that she would advise them as if she were like a perfect expert on their path. Everybody. But everyone had these different paths, but she seemed to be a perfect expert on their path, and I can tell you exactly what you need to do to dissolve the fixation that you're in now. And of course, it's called progressive gradualism endeavor, but it's really opposite of that. It's really, you're letting go of all effort. You're not becoming a master of effort. You're becoming one who lets go of all effort. And they call it emptiness, sunyata, emptiness. What's emptiness of fixation? Is of effort, really. Now, I flip the script on a lot of this stuff, but this is what the Adi Yogin does, flips the script in terms of perspective on all of it. And you say, well, we can never get to the top of the mountain. Actually, it's coming down off the mountain to inherent spaciousness, the smoothed out levelness. It's you can't help but let go of all this effort. It's a simple shift and it's gone. And you say, well, what happened to all my graduated, you know, how can I be a master if I don't know how I did this? No, I did it by letting go of all effort and no longer being interested in it. Not even in the effort of letting go of effort, I'm interested anymore. So, it doesn't matter what kind of effort you make, the result is the same. You'll end up in abidance, abiding in abidance, God in God as God, God experiencing God, which is, you'll end up in the recognition of intrinsic spaciousness, no matter how, what process you go through of letting go of effort. So if Longchenpa offers to help you out directly, like in my case, you know, this means he spots you as an Adi Yogin, someone who's taking the authenticity of intrinsic spaciousness is already nothing needs to be done to establish it. It's already authentic. I'm already in it. Now this is in general the Mahayana Buddhism does this. It's composed of Theravada or Hinayana Buddhism. And in Christianity, they also do it. What they do is they say, I'm already saved. Jesus saved me. I'm already saved from all my sins, meaning all my fixations and efforts. Jesus saw through all of them and then resurrected from the dead is showing you that he was able to completely see through all of it, all effort, even the effort of death. And so really Christianity is this type of Adi Yoga, if it's seen properly. It really is. Because Christianity is no method really, it's just that we're saved, already saved. We don't need to do anything to be saved. Jesus saved us, quote unquote. So this is so that if we could see this in the right context, you know, it's extremely profound religion and teaching. It's just like total Adi Yoga without anything else. Actually, they're trying to turn it into something else, but we're trying to keep that from happening here. It needs to be seen in the right context, and that is something that culturally was sort of embodied, and the problem is the embodiment culturally is gone, and this is causing Christianity to come unglued. This is the trouble. Remember, Christianity was done in community by those repentant minds, and the community of repentant minds is very important. Just like in Buddhism, the Sangha is very important. It's one of the refuges, right? The sutras, the tantras, the Sangha, whatever. These things are super helpful. So Christianity had these communities. It's very important. The churches, the communities of repentant minds, they were saying, look, we're just doing this path now. It's a very quick, direct path. We're already saved. It's already been accomplished. There's nothing we need to do at all. Just accept this fact. This is the highest teaching, actually. This is the most effective teaching, but it needs this, you know, community of like-minded repentance. So that helps it out. Without that, it becomes extremely difficult, as I have experienced. And so the undermining, sabotaging of culture into this gradualism is caused Christianity to basically collapse. And when it collapses, it gets goofy. You know, they don't understand. The rhetoric is still there, but it's so profound. It has to be understood. So it's like Tibetan Buddhism is actually helping rescue, like Longchamp is helping rescue Christianity, actually helping me see that it's the highest teaching, actually. It's just dispensed with all intermediate steps. This is quite a shocker. I didn't expect this to come across this in this video. It's not what I had planned. But hey, when something better comes along, you just jump on it. Say, okay. The fake Jesus stage is to get everyone, and the yoga girls is to get everyone into graduated endeavor again, which is just to try to beautify fixation in many ways. Let's spiritualize culture. This is really saying let's spiritualize fixation so it seems more attractive to us. This is what it's doing. Now when they say I'm saved by the blood of Jesus, this has to be clearly understood, but that there was a culture of intuitive understanding of this. But once that's gone, wow, you know, it's gone with the wind. This is you know, extremely the highest kind of teaching. It cannot be lowered down, otherwise the wheels come off. Christians say, I don't need to do anything to be saved. I'm already saved. Totally saved. Which is Dzogchen. I mean, it's really the highest radical Dzogchen teaching. It's the same. Extraordinary. A great proclamation, great recognition here. We don't need to abandon Jesus to do the highest teachings. Not at all. Not in the slightest bit. We just need to clearly see what he's really saying. What's really going on. Now, I have all those recognitions, but now I'm just putting it all together. I'm just... In the shock of the wow, I'm not going to struggle with explaining it at this moment too clearly, because this is a big shock. It's the highest teaching. We've been told that it's a lowly teaching, that the Hindu teaching's better, and the Buddhism teaching's better, because they have all this graduated endeavor in it, so many, many different techniques and paths and everything. We think, wow, we don't have any of that. So there's been a great falling away from high Christianity, so much, really, right? High Christianity, part of it was like Christian Science with Mary Baker Eddy. Was intuitively, that was sort of an intuitive grasping of it in a certain way. And it just says, you're not sick at all. There is no sickness. You know, you're not really, what you are is not fixated at all. Intrinsic spacious is never fixated. This is basically what they were saying. They had their own lingo. You know, there's a thing, the lingo's different, but intrinsic spaciousness is never fixated. It's always just what it is. You might just say, it's the one perfect fixation, and that's all there is. There's no way you can have some other fixation. There's only this one fixation of intrinsic spaciousness, and there isn't any other. So when they say we put all our sins on Jesus, we put all of our belief and fixation upon Jesus, even the fixation of death, that somehow that is some other fixation of intrinsic spaciousness. And then Jesus rose from the dead and said, no, it's not. Look, I'm free of all of it. His spirit is untouched by any of that. The one fixation we call God of intrinsic spaciousness is untouched by any other attempt at fixation. It's the perfect, one perfect fixation. intrinsic spaciousness is that, and just that. Shinasagar Maharaj, I am that. I am just that. I am that. I am thatness or suchness. I am suchness. It's the one fixation. God is the one perfect fixation without another. And so this is what Jesus was showing us. This is the whole, the Christian thing. It's powerful, 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 powerful. And the materialists have run it down. And see, I was always opposed to all these massive amount of means in the East. I said, no, no, no. I stayed away from it. That's not it. Now, I understand now. I have a much better recognition of what it is they're really doing. It's a very serious business, really. It's not child's play. It's progressively letting go of these fixations. And there are skillful means to do that. So I totally respect it all. But this is not how it comes out in the West and in the world in general. This is not what, and a lot of course, very serious students of this bemoan the way that it's been pop spirituality, the way it's been presented. I understand that too, recognize it. It's really been used to sabotage Christianity. You know, some of these teachings, like was it Shingon or Buddhism in Japan or something like that, it's secret. It's transmitted, orally transmitted from teacher to student, because it's not meant to be pop culture, part of pop culture at all, because they don't get it. It'll sabotage and undermine what they're doing, because dissolving our fixations is really backburning is what it does. Well, all these techniques are just backburning techniques, really. And it's possible to have vast numbers of ways to look at this. You know, we're burning this tree, we're burning that tree, we're burning this direction. It's all backburning. It's a way of letting go of fixations in a continuity, without our continuity fear overwhelming us. You know, the fear of the void, you know, like that. It's not a void, it's one perfect fixation. I had never seen it this way before, but this really helps us out a lot. God is the one perfect fixation of intrinsic spaciousness. There's just intrinsic spaciousness totally fixated as such, as suchness. And there's no other fixation. So all appearances arise, they're just ornamentation of that one fixation. Call it pure spaciousness, pure mind, pure awareness, pure consciousness, pure action. In Tibetan Buddhism, they would call even Ate, even the highest Ate yogas is divided into three, which is Samde, long day, and something else. I can't remember. Men something, Menak day or something. But what it means is Samde is mind, which would mean like consciousness, awareness, pure awareness. Long day is spaciousness, so the pure spaciousness, and then Mengag day, whatever it is, I'm mispronouncing it, is action, pure action, perfect action. So it's different ways of looking at it, which corresponds to the threefold nature, the trinity of Buddhism. It was exactly the same as Christianity, actually. The three attributes, they call it body, speech, and mind, or body, speech, action. Mind is one. Body, speech, and mind. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. All inseparably one fixation, one perfect fixation. So we're trying to add some other fixation upon the one fixation of inherent spaciousness. Inherent spaciousness is just everywhere. All that is, it's just one total, complete, vast, beyond all vastness, fixation as that. And we cannot change it at all. It's completely fixated. So we don't want to run into this confusion of thinking we're dissolving our fixations, so that means we need to dissolve God, the fixation of God. No, our fixations are an attempt to actually change the one fixation of that is God. We're trying to change God. We're trying to say that pure spaciousness is not fixated, perfectly fixated as pure spaciousness. That somehow something can wander out of intrinsic spaciousness. It's not true. So all these skillful means, yeah. Now Christianity has their skillful means too. But Christianity is just like this pure radical Dzogchen. Atta yoga of just, it's just one simple thing. Look, it's just all our sins. Jesus took them all away. We don't have them anymore. All our fixations were just fixated. We just accept the one fixation of Jesus, God, Holy Spirit, the Trinity, that one fixation. We just accept that. That's all. That's it. Nothing more than that. Remember, Christians have done an enormous number of miracles and reached enlightenment throughout history. But we're taking it easy here. The wow is very strong around this. And of course, gradualists scoff at this, as they do at Atta Yoga. I mean, the Nyingma tradition in Tibet was persecuted, severely persecuted for much of the time. And the Rime movement is designed to try and, you know, smooth that out, which is ecumenical movement. I think that was started in Kham, Eastern Tibet, which is where Dzogchen basically was most entrenched. The Nyingma tradition, the ancient tradition, the old translation tradition coming from Padmasambhava, and which is the sudden school, which is this already authentic school, which is just, you know, drop all fixations right now because there's just this one fixation that's untouched by all these others. We don't need to sort through all the completely ineffectualness, all the labels of it. Basically, we just have all these labels on total ineffectualness, ineffectiveness. Why do we need to sort through these labels? Is what we're saying. So Jesus offered up all our sins to God and saying, God, do what you want with these. If you want to sacrifice me, sacrifice me. And what did God do? Raise Jesus from the dead. Said, no, you're still my perfect son. See? And so that's the Christian message. Easter's coming up, which is the resurrection of Jesus. This is Palm Sunday. Actually, Palm Sunday is tomorrow. So this is pretty apropos that we're speaking of this, which is Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem in preparation for the crucifixion. And so basically, they offered up Jesus as a living sacrifice, meaning we put all our fixations upon Jesus, including the fixation of death. And we offer these up to you, God, and we will accept your judgment upon this. And what did God do? Raised Jesus from the dead and said, he's still my perfectly beloved son. No judgment at all, except no, just life. The one fixation is still the one fixation. That's all there is. So Christians know there's a powerful, powerful message here. And they're struggling to try and, you know, accept it. And radical Dzogchen, actually, from the true masters, really helps us. It's very helpful. These great teachers from Hinduism and Buddhism actually helped me understand Christianity, how great it is. They've revealed the greatness of it, actually. You know, it's the ultimate. It's just pure Atta Yoga. pure Dzogchen. I think Chen means greatness, you know, just all embracing greatness, and Zagpo Chenpo. Zagpo means completion of perfection, the great perfection. And long Chenpa, long means spaciousness. Chen means great, vast. You know, with just great vastness without measure. So the great, vast spaciousness. The Pa means, I guess, someone who's of that. So long Chenpa means the one who's expert, the Semdei Atiyogin of awareness of God as this vast, pure spaciousness, or inherent spaciousness, he would say, the fixation of inherent spaciousness. And another way of saying the fixation of inherent awareness would be the Semdei way of looking at it. And the other would be the fixation of perfect means, of perfect action, perfect expression, perfect experiencing, you might say. So these are three aspects of God. The awareness aspect, the inherent spaciousness aspect, and the inherent experiencing aspect. You might say the inherent spaciousness of it is God the Father. You might say this. I don't know how. This is what am I looking at? The inherent awareness would be God the Holy Spirit, and the inherent experiencing would be God the Son. So Christianity is looked as inferior by some of these religions because it doesn't have all these gradualism and skillful means that they're used to seeing. That's because it's a way of just leaving all that behind quickly. It's a fast approach. But you could say it's culturally sensitive to a large degree. And this is the trouble right now. Jesus said that the Christianity would collapse to such an extent. He said even the saints would be in a situation where they're going to lose their clarity. That's how bad it is going, and we're already at that. We're right there at this point, and these dramas that are being staged to come are going to designed to pull everyone down into more graduated endeavor, which can lead to the road to hell, which is more and more fixation. If the culture is not being pulled up by these great Ati Yoga and great Christian and great Mahasiddha teachers, if you want to call it that. I don't know. I don't like that term that much. Mahasiddha, great gurus, you might say. Mahasiddha is just all these practices, tantric practices designed to solve fixations. But siddhas are also paranormal powers, and you might say someone has all these paranormal powers. Well, that's not the goal. You know, we're not fixated on that at all here. So maybe all these great Bhagavan, like Ramana Maharshi, these great Mahatmas lifting everyone up out of graduated endeavor. If you don't have that, if you're not connected with that culturally, then graduated endeavor actually leads to hell. Hellish fixation. It's very bad. So graduated endeavor is for those who have a lot of continuity fear and not a lot of discipline to gradually dissolve their fixations. But this only works if it's done in a culture which has a deeper current to it, which is leading you to higher practices. They say that the path of like Theravada needs to then ultimately take the path of Mahayana, the path of the Arhant, arhat, these become the path of the bodhisattva, so to speak. This is what they say, meaning the path of gradual effort leading to one's liberation, but just nothing more than that, needs to lead to the path of realizing no effort and then being a bodhisattva to help inspire all who are stuck in this graduated effort. It's important to have these great bodhisattvas, these great saviors like Jesus, who personifies the direct approach. The great personification of the direct approach. He whereas the Buddha gave out so many sutras, so many oral teachings, and this got developed into so many, many bifurcations of so many skillful means, which is all fine, right, it is. As long as, the cultural pull is going up to, from the great bodhisattvas. Where Jesus is just Jesus, and he didn't give out all this, these skillful means and gradual efforts, graduated effort type of things. He didn't do that. It was this very dramatic, I gave everything to God. It says, God, into my hands I commend my spirit with all the sins of the people upon me. Okay, he took all the sins of the people upon him, allowing them to crucify him. And he put that before God. I better get moving here. And then said, God, judge me, judge everyone, be the judge of everyone. I'm putting all the sins of everyone in front of you simultaneously here. That's the kind of faith Jesus had in God, knowing that God would say, you're my perfect son. There's no fixation except God fixation. There isn't any other. Jesus knew it, so he had this tremendous faith in God and took all the sins of the whole universe upon himself and put it all together as one, not as a graduated effort, as all at once into God, and said, okay, God, judge me. And God said, there's no judgment upon you whatsoever. So this is why people call Jesus, the great teacher, justifiably so, actually. He just did it all at once like this. No graduated endeavor at all for any of it. He took all graduated endeavor, everything, put it all together all at once for God to judge. Says, judge me. And God said, there's no judgment upon you. Rise from the dead. You're with me here in heaven, in the kingdom. You're at my right hand, meaning you are the Son of God, exactly as I created you. And you dwell in the glory of this one perfect fixation, awareness, spaciousness, inherent spaciousness, and experiencing. That means we also dwell there too. We also dwell there too. He is the representative of all of us. And so you see it this way, you just say, wow. I'm seeing it more clearly now. So Christianity is a great religion, actually. Really great religion. That's why it's being targeted so severely. The magazines, the pundits, the books. There's an all-out effort to destroy Christianity and replace it with graduate endeavor. And you know who's come to the defense of Christianity? I'll tell you who came to the defense of Christianity. Ananda Maimā came to the defense of Christianity. Ramana Maharshi came to the defense of Christianity. Longchenpa came to the defense of Christianity. And Jesus came to the defense of Christianity. First, Jesus, obviously, goes without saying, but I'll say it. They're the ones who are coming to the defense of Christianity because they understand the greatness of it. And you don't see these other religions being attacked like Christianity because they have so much graduated endeavor. It's easy to pull them, easier to pull them down. Once you get this materialistic culture, it's easy to pull them down. It's tougher to pull Christianity down because they don't have this tradition of graduated endeavor. So for Christians, it's all or nothing. So they're having so the number one enemy of the New World Order is Christianity, by far, far and away. So thank you for all of those of you who have stuck with this, thinking, is he a Christian? Is he not? What's going on here? Now you're seeing, indeed I am. And that these other teachers, indeed they are too. Because it's at the top, it's all one. It's all one understanding of God, okay, of truth. And they know very well of the trouble of graduated endeavor. Longchenpa is the perfect genius of this. So he knows very well the profundity of Christianity. It's pure Atta Yoga, pure Dzogchen, actually. The ultimate Dzogchen. Jesus was the ultimate Dzogchen master, really. If you look at it, because he put it all, just that's all he did. He just put all fixation, he brought it all to God simultaneously. Simultaneously. No graduated effort whatsoever on Jesus' part. This is just, you know, absolutely the highest of the high. You can't get any better than that. And said, you know, judge it all at once, God. I'm willing to accept your judgment upon me. I'm putting it all in front of you simultaneously. I'm not saying a little bit here, and maybe you'll judge that, but I'm holding some other back from judgment. No, he put it all simultaneously, concurrently, simultaneously for judgment. It says, make one judgment upon all of this, and I will accept your judgment. Doesn't get any better than that. And then God's judgment? No, you're my perfect son. I don't even see any of this. It's nothing. You've never sinned against me. That's the resurrection. So that's why Christians celebrate Easter. But they don't know. It's an intuitive thing within them, but they're not really keenly, you know, connecting with it like we are here. We're really keenly seeing it here. And so we can't be bullied around anymore, can we? By the gradualists. Christianity has been very severely bullied and sabotaged, actually. Many sabotage experts came in to try to sabotage it. Demolition experts, actually. And they threw all this tricky, you know, Mahasiddha, tantric stuff at us, you know, gradualism, all these various things. As we got all these means and blah, 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 blah. But who came to our rescue? The ones who are above all that. Ramana Maharshi, he's totally above all that. He said, who am I? Just very simple. Anandamayama, completely above all that. Not attached to any of it. Having done all of it, yet remaining completely untouched by all. Having done all gradual means, remaining completely untouched by all of it. Not favoring anything else, just absolutely beyond it all. Longchenpa, the perfect genius of all graduated endeavors, and saying no, you know, there's a better approach. Just rest in inherent spaciousness and inherent awareness and inherent perfect action. It's already that way. They're the ones helping rescue Christianity. Because, yeah, and the assault against Christianity is just viciously severe and will get worse and worse and worse. Don't get caught up in it. We've already rescued. It's already rescued here. It's already rescued. And thank God for these teachers. Because they said, no, don't think that these other religions can sabotage Christianity in the slightest bit. We're here to tell you that's not true at all. without losing any respect for these religions. I have the ultimate respect for these religions, because under the right circumstances, they do dissolve fixations all the way to realization of the threefold inherentness, fixation of God, one fixation in three aspects: awareness, spaciousness, and experiencing. They do work, but it has to be under the right cultural conditions, under the right help and support. Absolutely, it does. So this is very amazing, very astonishing what's occurred this morning here. Very grateful for it, and I need to do some work now. So I will do that. Make a few pennies, try to keep from sinking, but, and all glory to the Holy Spirit who keeps us afloat, right? And is, all right, so very great. Just absorb all this. It's very shocking information. Just absorb it. Full stop in the wow again, right? You know how to do that. We've been focusing this over and over and over and over and over. Take no action. Don't run. No running. No running back behind this way. No running that way. No running in an erratic way. Don't think about running. Don't plan to run. Don't decide to run. And don't run. Just full stop in the well. Very great. That's it for this one.